Over the past 12 months, Generation One has built a movement of over 110,000 people who are working to end the disparity between Indigenous and non-Indigenous people in Australia. While realising the employment gap between Indigenous and non-Indigenous Australians is a complex and multi-dimensional challenge, the clear focus of Generation One has, from its origin, been on creating pathways to sustainable employment through education and focused training directly tied to jobs. Employment may not change everything for Indigenous people, but without it, nothing will change. Generation One is developing a draft policy looking at skills and training required for sustainable employment.
It's like anything, it's number one, it's you. You look yourself in the mirror and say, well, how do I get out of this hole that I'm in? Do I look at all my relations here in 20 years' time in the same crap that they're in? Or you sit and say, well, I'm going to make a change. And the only one who can do that is yourself.
Those schools that continually successfully produce kids into employment have got the right-minded school counsellors. They're looking for life beyond school for the kid, not just to keep the kid at school.
There's been a sea change, I think, in business looking at this and saying, you know, what can we do or how do we do things, rather than it's too hard. And I think business coming in has led to more innovation. I think it's looked, you know, it's led to people looking for direct solutions. It's led to people taking more risks.
That's your workmate, and every time you've got a person like that who attaches themselves as a friend in the business, a workmate, then the chance of that Indigenous person staying, working out the rules, working out what's expected of them, all the personal issues, which are terribly important because they've got a friend they can rely on, the chance of that person staying and becoming successful goes through the roof.
This policy aims to open up the dialogue between business, training organisations and communities that bring together people, simplifies pre-employment training and support, and encourages all Australians to end the disparity. The aim is not to reinvent the wheel, but to help create longer-term partnerships, enable sustainable support and encourages new approach to Indigenous training that is employer-directed.
I think it's giving Aboriginal people a choice, and to go into employment, to get off welfare, to turn their lives around.
Following the high-profile launch of Generation One in March 2010, the team and I embarked on a national roadshow across Australia, visiting communities in regional, urban and remote areas. As part of this roadshow, we talked to people on the ground about what was working in Indigenous employment and training and published these stories. Generation One hosted an ideas forum on creating sustainable Indigenous employment with representatives from Indigenous employment and training organisations, businesses and non-for-profit. This was broadcast live and viewed by over 1,000 supporters. We are asking all Australians to participate, especially in the support of Generation One, as this is your movement. Go to the Generation One website and download the draft policy paper, and then submit your ideas or feedback via the website. Go to our website to find out more. Submit your ideas or register to attend an event. We hope you can be a part of this important journey with us.
My name is Marcia Langton, and I'm here on behalf of the University of Melbourne's Murrumburra Institute for Indigenous Partnerships. And I'll give you the apologies from Professor Ian Anderson, our Professor of Indigenous Health. Thank you all for coming. I'll acknowledge that we are on the land of the Kulin Nations, and here at the University of Melbourne we have a wonderful relationship with the Wurundjeri people, who are the traditional owners here. And in time, I hope Diane Kerr from the Wurundjeri Council will be here. I'd just like to say that the Wurundjeri turn up here at our university regularly and make sure that we know who they are and we have a great partnership with them. Before we begin, could you please turn your mobiles off? And if you intend to tweet, please turn your phone to silent. If you want to follow the Twitter conversation, the hashtag is #Gen1. That's #GenOne. The forum is going to be streamed live over the internet. So if you do not wish to be filmed or photographed, you should be sitting in the wing to my left. If you need to move, please move now. We have a fantastic panel for you today, which I am sure will provoke and challenge you. So please feel free to ask questions and respond to any of the comments put forward by our panellists today. There are two roving microphones, so please put your hand up and we will get a microphone to you. After this discussion today, I hope your business or organisation will go to the Generation One website and upload a formal response to the draft policy paper we are discussing today. I'll repeat those details for you later. The forum will run for 90 minutes and conclude at midday. If you need to leave the room to use the bathrooms, please do so quietly. There are the exits. And then try and come back in and to the back of the room if possible. I would like now to invite Andrew Forrest to give us an overview of the... Andrew, I should introduce everybody. I'm sorry. Very nervous.
You're doing great.
So let me introduce Andrew first. He's the founder of the Movement for Change, Generation One, as well as the Australian Employment Covenant, known as the 50,000 Jobs Campaign. I'd like to introduce James Packer, Executive Chairman of Consolidated Press Holdings, and importantly, an employer who has signed up to the 50,000 Jobs Campaign. And Christine Ross is an Aranda Kaidich Desert woman from the Northern Territory, a teacher by trade, and more recently has been working for Burswood Entertainment Complex in Perth, which falls under the Consolidated Press Holdings Group. Here is Madonna. Madonna Beattie is a Gubbi Gubbi woman from Queensland who has been working in Western Australia for the last 15 years and is the owner of Nyaarla Projects. And on the end is Adrian Appo, a Gurang Gurang man from Queensland and social entrepreneur and chief executive officer of Ganbina, based in the Goulburn Valley here in Victoria. Last Friday, we received fabulous news. The Australian Employment Covenant reached the goal of creating 50,000 employment opportunities across Australia for Indigenous Australians. So the man... So the man who set all this up, Andrew Forrest, is here to tell us more about it. So, over to you, Andrew.
Thank you very much. Would you like to go to the lectern, do you know?
I think I meant to go to the lectern, so I'll just do what I'm told. Can everyone hear me okay? Start, may I just thank you all and welcome you very warmly for coming. It's terrific to have you here and everyone online. Thank you very much for your interest. To my fellow panellists, really great effort. You've come from all over Australia representing Indigenous people everywhere, and I thank you and bow to you. Thank you so much. Ladies and gentlemen, I suppose really I'm the bacon in this pan. I have no choice about it. I have to do what I do. I'm completely driven by it. I've grown up with Aboriginal people. They grew up with me, and in many ways they made me and helped me grow up. I've seen over time what the effects of welfare, subsequent social disintegration and social poverty has had on our beautiful First Australian people. And I just feel, like all of you here today, that there is a much, much better road than welfare, that there is now a choice, and it's a choice I put to every leading Australian business person, chief executive or chairman,
who would be kind enough to take my call in the last two or three years, to put to them that their only way out of welfare, the only way out of the poverty trap of our Indigenous people is employment, and that a change is happening right across Australia, and they should get amongst that change. They should help Australia change, and they should really put their own shoulder hard to that wheel. Not through their human resources departments, not through their chief diversity officers, not through any of these wonderful titled people, but through themselves, to lead their organisation from the front and ensure the whole organisation changes to one that actively seeks, actively yearns to give opportunity to our first Australian, but not for charity. I don't believe anyone should be here because we're big-hearted fellas. I think we're here, well, I'd like you to be here, because there's a sustainable change underway which will live long past us and remove the hideous blight of the disparity from the Australian landscape. And changing that landscape, ladies and gentlemen, are what you are all about. You're now supported by nearly 300 of the smaller to the most leading companies. They, at last count, have committed 57,822 jobs. So we hit the 50,000, and it's growing, and it's growing, and it's growing, and it's growing because that change we refer to is real. That within the hearts, and particularly within the minds of our chief executives and chairmen across Australia, they're standing up and saying, we know there is now a way out of the disparity. Only a few years ago we didn't. Only a few years ago we knew the only solution was 20-odd billion dollars a year, which would disappear without much trace into supporting welfare. When we can turn that from people who do not want to be where they are to people who are making an active contribution to themselves, most importantly, to their families and to society. Paying their own way, doing what the Aboriginal people did, which I grew up with. They were social leaders in their communities. They did the ceremonies, they led their culture, they did the circumcisions, they built the culture of their communities. And at the same time, they walked equally and strongly in the Western world. They led me, they led my family's business, and they could do both comfortably. Similar to a Chinese billionaire I had dinner with recently. Let me assure you, he was very Chinese, spiritually, culturally, everything. But when it came to putting bread on his table, he engaged with the rest of the world beautifully. He walked comfortably and happily in those two worlds. So can, of course, our Indigenous brothers and sisters. But they have to have that opportunity. They have to have now a flood-lit path to a job. For years, for decades, unfortunately for generations, we've obscured that path. We've suffered in ourselves a racism of low expectations. I walk into Aboriginal communities now across Australia. The racism of low expectations for themselves is alive and well there still. But now we have that landscape changer. Now we know forever the landscape has changed. There is this overwhelming demand, a demand-side pull if you're an economist, to employ Indigenous people, to give them every opportunity, and that now must be shared by our government. It must be shared by all of us, and it must be shared through the only way now which makes that floodlit path. We have the solution. It's employment. We now must not cloud it with training which leads to nowhere, not cloud it with training which is well meant but has no result, not cloud it with anything but that guaranteed result of a job if you pass that training. And in the last 15 years that I've been doing this, where I've been guaranteeing a job to Indigenous people who submit and undergo that training, where they believe us when we say, we won't put you into your first day at work where you're feeling unprepared and unskilled. where you're feeling like people are looking at you charitably. That's history. We understand why you resented that. We understand why you became cynical of that. But we'll put you into work now where you feel you're value adding from that very first day. So if I could just show you just a quick couple of stories which I videoed only last fortnight. Thank you.
Well, I've had a pretty rough life. I had a heroin problem. I was a heroin addict for 15 years. I've been in and out of the prison system for a while now. I hit rock bottom there a few times. I got out last month. I've just done 6 years. I've had enough. I really want to change. I come to Port Hedland. I've got a sister here. She helped me get through the BTAC services. They've helped me a lot since I've been here. I qualified for my driver's license yesterday, which I never thought I'd get because a lot of car thefts and stuff like that there. But change is good, and I'm there to change now.
I started off as, for 2 years, I lived in the back of a car in the back of South Hedland. And my education wasn't brilliant. I really couldn't read or write. And 2 years, the car I lived in was in the, that I borrowed in the back of South Hedland. And I was thinking one day, seeing other people living in the gutters and that, and I wasn't too far from it. I was going down. One day I said, nah, enough's enough. I need to get my kids a better education than whatever I had, and so that they can be somebody in this world. So I went and got a job, and from that job, I never looked back. I got my own house now, I got my own car, and my advice would be just get up and just do it, and don't look back.
So now I'd like to welcome everyone who's online. And to you, thank you so much for joining us at the University of Melbourne for the Generation One Discussion Forum. Welcome. And a special welcome to Tanya Major, the Generation One spokesperson who is watching live online from Queensland. To those of you who are online, if you would like to join the Twitter conversation, the hashtag is #Gen1. That's #GenOne. And perfect timing, Diane.
Good morning.
Welcome. I'd like to introduce to you Diane Kerr from the Wurundjeri Council.
I'm a great supporter of Generation One and have been for a while now, and I am so, so proud of the young ones that I have been dealing with and what they do. They are proud young Aboriginal people, and they're our leaders of the future. And I get very overwhelmed when I deal with them because I keep updated with them. I support them solely as a Wurundjeri traditional owner of Melbourne, and they come here quite often to the University of Melbourne. And I love the way that people want to interact. They've reached their goal, from what I hear. They've excelled their goal, and they should be so proud. And people like yourselves should be proud to be associated with them. I think they're wonderful, and I think the initiative is great. Too often that Aboriginal people have been offered jobs without any training and they've been set up to fail. This is a chance for our children to show that they can do it, they will do it, they'll succeed, and I tell you, they'll be your friend for life. When you become part of the Aboriginal community, you're a friend for life. And that is really special. So I'd like to ask each and every one of you that are here today to get to understand someone that you don't know, talk to them, share your culture, hear what they have to say. Because if we can do that, we can live in harmony. If we can live in harmony, our children can live in peace. So I'd like to offer you my hand in friendship, in cultural respect and dignity, so that we can live together in harmony. May Bunjil, my creator, surround you and keep you safe on country. On behalf of my elders, I say Wamindika, which means welcome. I wish to welcome you from the tops of the trees to the roots in the ground. And if you look after the country will look after you. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Diane. And I'm sure that everybody in the room completely agrees with you, and we thank you so much for your welcome to country. Today's the Elders' Lunch. So Diane's off to the Melbourne Elders' Lunch. Have a wonderful time. So to the audience online, it's important that Generation One hears your feedback, your ideas, and understands what experience you've had. So together we can ensure pre-employment and training operates in the most efficient and effective way, ensuring that candidates start on day one, knowing the formal and informal rules of the workplace, and importantly, how to do the job they have been employed to do. As I said before, last Friday we heard the wonderful news that the Australian Employment Covenant, established by Andrew and his family, reached the goal of creating over 50,000 employment opportunities across Australia for Indigenous Australians. That's a wonderful achievement. It's not something that I thought I'd see, but I'm thrilled with all the hard work and this key achievement. This is what will work. Andrew, you're the founder of the Australian Employment Covenant and Generation One. Do you want to give us a bit more background on the thinking behind the 50,000 jobs campaign and Generation One?
Yeah, thank you, Marcia. The thinking is really in everything I've ever done or any company I've started at the end. If you can envisage, if you can imagine what Australia looks like without a disparity, then start there and then work back all the steps which it takes to get to where you are now, which was a few years ago, where there was a clear and growing disparity. That imagination led me to employment. Employment is the only way to kill the disparity stone dead. And so to create that, we started the Employment Covenant with the full support of the government. And look, it's fair to say it's a tight covenant. It's brief, but it binds you to guarantee opportunities to Aboriginal people. And not every chief executive, not every chairman, legal department would let them sign it. It's not an ambition. It's not a target. It's a tight agreement. And 300 of Australia's great companies submitted themselves to that obligation, and I now know we have a road out of the disparity. And we have to clothe that with that clear and floodlit path from where an Indigenous person is now to training, which is job-specific, employer-directed training to that guaranteed job. Thank you. I might leave you, if I could, with a short video which the Generation One team put together. Thank you very much. Thanks. Thank you.
I was hooked on heroin and alcohol too, pretty bad.
Growing up as a young child, I started drinking very young.
My self-esteem about drinking, my drinking issues, and not feeling confident in actually applying for work.
Made my self-esteem very low, and you didn't feel like a proper dad, you know, you couldn't support your own family because not enough money.
We had to live from pay to pay, and that was the biggest downfall, where we couldn't afford things.
You haven't got enough money for your family to feed and to clothe. You're looking for that, where your next money coming from.
The negative effects of living a life of alcohol, drugs and crime can have be passed on in a cycle through down to your younger peers.
A few close mates of mine had passed away, you know, OD'd and that. And also I was just reflecting on my own, you know, when I finally straightened up and...
I wanted a better life. I wanted to be able to walk into a shop and say, yep, I can afford that.
My father can do it. I want to be just like him and have a decent job and support my family and bring them up right.
And the judge actually gave me three options of going 6 foot under, heading straight to prison, or getting out of his court and going creating a living for myself. So I took the third choice. Here I am today.
Now that I'm employed, it's like, oh, Dad's always been out working, earning money, and now it's Mum's turn. And
I think by changing my life, people have actually seen my health get better.
Oh, it's unbelievable the amount of self-confidence it's given me and respect.
Everyone has respect for everyone when you see someone out there working and say, good on you. You know, it's a pat on the back.
Knowing that we can afford the rent and knowing that we can reach our goals to buy a house is the main thing of securing a good job.
I can actually further my career within the mining industry and also look after my family.
My son say, we want to be like you now, Dad. And that makes me pretty proud, eh? And my parents, Mum and Dad, they say, encourage me all the time, you know, they've come saying I've come a long way and just keep booming me up, and oh, it's awesome. The effect that it's had on my family is unbelievable.
Well, I feel like I've gained so much respect from family members that thought that wasn't worth anything of that.
I believe the best way for Indigenous people to make the first step is don't be afraid. Take the chance, take the step.
You talk to somebody, it doesn't, it could be your uncle, your aunties, your mum, dad, could be an organisation like BTEC or someone. Just talk to someone and, you know, an education, that's another main thing. Make sure you have a real crack at the education, because that'll help you out heaps. And yeah, but just persevere, and it may be hard sometimes, but you just got to keep going, and anyone can do it. Now your exit's here, it's waiting just for you. Don't pause too long, it's fading now, it's ending all too soon, you'll see.
So I'd like to ask you a question, James. Your organisation, which includes Crown Casino and Burswood Entertainment Complex, was one of the first businesses to sign up to the Covenant in 2008. I've seen firsthand the Indigenous Employment Program that runs at Crown here in Melbourne with the wonderful young Charles Williams. But what was your motivation for being part of this national jobs campaign?
Thanks, Marcia, and it's a great thrill to be here today. I wish I could be altruistic and say it was my deep, lifelong desire to singularly help the Aboriginal people. The truth is that Andrew and Nicola. And I started talking about it a little bit, and Andrew and Nicola were so infectious that that it became very easy for me to want to hitch, in a small way, our carriage to their bandwagon. So I think that Andrew's enthusiasm is something, you know, in corporately, but on this issue is really why we're all here today, and it's a great thing for Australia and something he should be very proud of.
I agree. Christine, you worked for the last 2 years at the Burswood Entertainment Complex in Perth. How important was it to have that leadership from James, and how did that filter down to an operational level to actually get Indigenous people working in Burswood?
Right, very good question. First thing I'll do before I answer it, Marcia, is just acknowledge that we are on Wurundjeri people's country. I'm a visitor to your beautiful country and I acknowledge that. I'd love to acknowledge the other brothers and sisters that are here, and particularly the Aranda people who I know are in this room, my people. And yesterday there was a plane load of Territorians that flew down. We left 30 degrees to come here. And I think this is particularly important, this forum, because it's NAIDOC week. This is our week, it's Aboriginal week. And to have this forum is very fitting for that. And the theme, of course, this year is change, the next step is ours. It's fabulous to have the support of James and Andrew in setting up this program, but now as Aboriginal people, we have to take it and run with it. And it's fabulous to see the video. As Marcia said, I spent the last 2 years working at Burswood. For those of you that have been to Perth, it is the largest single site employer within WA. And as you know, we have a mining boom happening over there. So for an industry that's located in Perth to employ that many people on one site, which we're talking about 4,500 people, is quite a huge business. My role there was a coordinator. My challenge was to set up the Aboriginal employment program. It was very much a learning curve, not just for myself, but also for Burswood, because they'd never gone into this on the scale that they have. It made such a huge difference to have the support of our chairman and the support to our CEO and all of our executive, because unless you've got that in a business, it's not going to work. Marcy has already acknowledged Charles Williams, who's sitting here. Charles and I began at the same time, and for us it's been an amazing journey. The most important thing is giving Aboriginal people employment. That is what makes the difference to our people and in their lives, and we've heard some personal stories. For the people that I recruited into Burswood, it was the first job for many that they'd ever had. You're dealing with a very diverse group of Aboriginal people. And we're very conscious of that. You get Aboriginal people, they'll hit the ground running, they can go straight into the jobs, no worries. Others need a lot of mentoring. I think the success of our program, both at Crown and Burswood, is the fact it was headed up by Aboriginal people. And that was the major difference. Because if you're gonna run Aboriginal programs, have Aboriginal people running them. And these days, there's absolutely no reason why we shouldn't be. I was fortunate to have a team of people over at Burswood. They were all Aboriginal people, a full-time mentor. That was crucial to the program. Running Aboriginal cultural awareness. You cannot set up a program like this and not run cultural awareness, because people have no understanding of why sometimes we do things a little bit different. I think it was important for the Noongar community in Perth to see that a corporate business was doing something positive, and it made good business sense to employ local Noongar people. I mean, there's Aboriginal people working there from all around Australia. Previous to me starting there and us signing up to the AEC, not a lot of Aboriginal people had been employed at Burswood, but all of a sudden, within 6 months, our numbers shot up to 45 from 8, and now it's seen as a choice employer in WA. Because not everybody wants to go and work on the mine site. So for me, it's been positive. It's positive for Burswood. It's positive for Aboriginal people. Our retention rate sits at about 70%. which in an industry like hospitality where you have major turnover is quite an achievement. So to be seen as best practice is a major thing, and we are certainly very grateful for James and Andrew on setting us on that path. Thanks.
Thank you. If I can... If I can just, you know, add something to what Chris said, I've actually had less to do with this than anyone. Andrew sort of motivated me in the start, and then Christine and Charles did a great job, but our company was named by the government last year as the best Aboriginal employer in Australia, so we are actually doing some things quite well. And one of the things that I think's often not thought about quite as much as it should be by the general public is you see a fantastic video like the one we saw today, and it's incredibly motivating and it's filled with amazing success stories. But approximately 70% of Aboriginals in Australia, our Indigenous brothers and sisters, live in the metropolitan cities, and it's very easy to see sometimes images of the outback and obviously, you know, what the mining boom has done in terms of creating opportunities is an incredible thing and something that it's fantastic that it's occurred from every perspective, especially Aboriginal employment. But finding a way for the 70% of our Indigenous brothers and sisters who live in the cities to get work is, you know, obviously the numbers speak for themselves, so that's very, very important. So for a company like us, we're an unusual company, people mightn't realise, but Crown in Melbourne is actually the largest single site employer in Australia, with over 10,000 people working there. And in Western Australia, Burswood's the largest single site employer in Western Australia as well, which is pretty incredible when you think of all the big mining projects, et cetera, that are going on there. For us, that's been a big advantage in this program because mentoring and things of that nature that Chris spoke about are so important. And for, as I understand it, for our Aboriginal employees to be able to have friends and colleagues who they can be working with so they don't feel that isolation, and when they have a bad day, they can share feelings, thoughts, ideas, et cetera, et cetera. But Christine and Charles have done an amazing job, so thank you guys.
Thanks, James. Thanks, Christine. There's more to be explored there, but we'll come back to that. Madonna, who I first met at the Yargyle Diamond Mine airstrip about 15 years ago, organising a festival for children, owns Nyaarla Projects. Now, Madonna, you're helping young people to make the transition from training to work. Give us a bit more background on the work you're doing in Western Australia.
Nyaarla Projects is one part of who we are, and then Madala is our not-for-profit organisation. Between Nyaarla and Madala, the significant programs that we run are the IYMP program, the Indigenous Youth Mobility Program, and the Indigenous Youth Leadership Programs. And we also have a Sporting Chance program that we run out of Fitzroy Crossing. And I have to say with Christine that, you know, the great thing about what we do is working with community. And we do that first, before we even engage the participants, we find out who their significant person is. Now that person can be an elder, it can be an aunt, or it can be a school teacher or whoever, because we absolutely do our business on mentoring, and mentoring is what gets our participants through. Yes, they are the ones that do the work, but without that mentoring, that solid mentoring from every aspect of their life, and we as a culture, that's how we do what we do, is mentoring. Within the Aboriginal community, that's what we do. We pass on from one generation to the next generation to the next generation, and that's all it is. It is mentoring. And people question, oh, what is this mentoring? But what it is someone giving direction to someone else. And that's what the whole of getting jobs is about, and having a goal to aim for. Now, we can go back on our history and look at all those things that caused or came about that the disparity is there. But as Andrew says, we have to light this path. We have to light it up and light it up with things that are real, real jobs. And we are the most trained people in the world, I think, Aboriginal people. We have traineeship after traineeship after traineeship. Well, you know, that doesn't change the economic situation of our people. But we also have to educate our people, because if we're not educated, what do we have? Because we live in a world that is about education. And so it's education in where we have to go in the white man's world, and it's education of who we are, because a lot of that is lost and a lot of healing has to be done. And you see these kids out, the participants we have are 16 to 24, and they're lost. Some of them come and they're lost, and that's because they're in between two worlds. And so it's designing a program that can take them forward, that they can transition into both worlds.
Can I, would you mind if I endorse that? Marcia, you and I have just recently met, but I just couldn't agree with your comments more strongly. It's been our exact experience as well. The great thing about having a chairman or a chief executive sign onto the covenant, not someone else in the business, is that part of the covenant is about mentoring. And at one of our mine sites, our mentoring's just been okay, and our turnover there has been 60-odd percent, 50-odd percent, you know, it's kind of getting up there. And, you know, I'm not that proud of it, or our retention rate. Back in our port, where we've been more hands-on encouraging mentors and to remove for all time this fallacy that they've got to be paid or professional mentors, they've actually got to have the most important qualification of all, that's the heart to be a mentor.
Absolutely.
And then people like James would ask for volunteers, say, look, I'm going to be a mentor and I'd like as many people in my organisation to step up and be mentors as well. Well, hey, if the boss is doing it, it must be all right. So you get people who volunteer to mentor. Now in our port, we have nearly 40% Aboriginal participation in the workforce. It won't always be the way, Madonna, but it's right now we've got zero turnover. So I know it can be done. Yeah. And I know it's as a result of that guaranteed job with training and mentorship.
When we first started, we made mistakes, and we're still making mistakes, and that's not what it's about. We had to stop working from our head and come to our heart. And you cannot buy that. I don't care who you are, where you are. If you're not coming from your heart and have the passion to change and make a real difference, you haven't got anything.
Yeah.
And so we had to learn that within our organisation. We had to stop doing the numbers game. Oh yes, because Dewar has to have numbers, you have to tick off, you know, that's life. You, the policy changes in here, like, is there advice? But you have to.
Yeah.
That's business, and you do, and you've got to make a dollar.
Yeah.
Or else what do you have? But there are certain things you can do, and looking at the individual and taking that individual forward and not setting them up to fail. Because if you play the numbers game, that's what you're doing.
Exactly.
You're setting them up to fail.
Yeah. So, look, can I just really emphasise that to be a mentor, your primary qualification is to want to be a mentor. You know, once you've got that, you're on the road to being a great mentor.
Yeah. That's right. I've mentored a few kids over the years. One of them was Tanya. That was a hoot. She was about 18 and an incredible discus thrower. So I can tell you, I really behaved myself. Adrian, in the Goulburn Valley, you've been working to give young people life skills for employment through the Jobs for You 2 program, with a vision to ensure that in two generations, Indigenous people will share the economic benefits of the Goulburn Valley in a more equitable manner. Why was there a need for your program?
I think if if I was to reflect back on the Jobs for You 2 program, and the Jobs for You 2 program is exactly as it is. It's Jobs for You 2, and that's the message that we were putting out to the, especially the young people, and I'll explain that a little bit, in our community, is that there are jobs, and basically for you too. Is 96, I think there was a discussion, in, obviously, as which I was a part of community leaders, and we were actually looking at this whole thing of Indigenous unemployment. And what we started to, realise or uncover was the fact that when we were looking at unemployment, is you were looking at people who were actually unemployed, strangely enough. But unemployment was not necessarily one of their only, issues that they had around their lives. Is normally when they were turning up as unemployed, there could be homelessness, drug issues, and we had some of those in those stories that were actually there. And so we started to think along the lines of, look, if we're only going to be working with people who are unemployed, we're always going to be working from a deficit point of view. And in many cases, multiple deficits, because unemployment, as I said, just wasn't the only problem. The other thing that we realised is that when we looked at work readiness for the unemployed, and normally is around the government programs of the day, is that there was a minimalistic time that you could engage with the person for, and then you had to put them into a job, very much on the thing, you had to kind of move them through the system in a specified period and collect your dollars along the way. So the other realisation was, deficit point of view. The other thing was is that in terms of that small portion of time that you could work with the individual is really for those who were work ready and reading the discussion paper, I think if anything comes out of that discussion paper, you should really highlight that word work ready. In fact, there's three things: education, training for employment, and work readiness. I think are three big key words that are in the discussion paper and certainly need to be to come through. Is what we found was is that you work with the individual who is unemployed, it's basically as you're putting them into entry level jobs. And really that wasn't reflective of the community. And Shepparton, for those who don't know, is a fairly affluent community with primary production around fruit and dairy, manufacturing up of those. In fact, 1% of Australia's GDP comes out of the region, and it's the export market overseas. So if we were to be representative of the community in equal economic participation, is how was that reflected if the majority of the Aboriginal community was actually working in the Aboriginal sector servicing unwell Aboriginal people or at entry-level jobs? So we actually said what we needed to do is actually be across the spread of industry that were around and also going vertically within those. So in terms of going into management, going into professional levels. And if we're only going to operate with the unemployed, that it would be very limited in terms of the impact. The other thing that we started to look at, this was in 96, 97, and obviously a deep conversation, because getting information is very difficult around these sort of things. People don't want to share where things aren't going well. Is what we found was that young people, why weren't they going into employment? And basically is what they were saying is, well, we're not going to get a job, so let's go on the dole or the rock and roll now. That's going to be our destiny. We can live that at, 13, 14 and 15. So 13, 14 and 15, that's those early years of secondary school education. And so what we thought was is, well, we can work in one area and be slightly, make a slight impact, or we could actually change and look at, let's invest in a longer term investment and make a bigger change. And so for us, as we actually said, well, let's actually work with young people and support them through and show them the value of education, the value of training, and create aspiration, not only in terms of entry level jobs, but create aspiration into any sort of industry that they actually could see or perceive themselves in. And develop processes that would support them to achieve those aspirations. Now, I'd probably like to say that we've been very, very successful in that. But being the success of that is that it's taken us from 2004 to 2011 to now actually see the return, on that. And I think one of the great examples is a young guy that's studying at Melbourne University here. You know, he came to me, he was in his second year of Melbourne Uni this year, and said, look, I really want to go into commercial banking. Now, I can't understand why you'd want to do that myself. But, you know, this is what he wanted to do. Now, this is a young fellow that's been on our program since he was 13. Now, if we were to actually say, no, look, this is what we can get you as a job here, is, you know, how much would we have undersold, you know, where his aspirations were and ultimately where he could possibly be? Because he's now actually got an internship this year with, you know, one of the largest, you know, in Goldman Sachs, commercial banking firms. And I think, yeah, that is the success that we actually see from a, you know, a long-term approach, and the investment that the Shepparton and Golden Valley community saw that we needed, because we wanted to break the welfare cycle, and we didn't always want to be operating from that deficit point of view of selling a message of be unsuccessful and fail, and then we will come in and try and help you.
Yes, yeah. Exactly. It's as Andrew says, the soft bigotry of low expectations. And if we hold those views ourselves, we hold ourselves back. Yeah. So we've got to have respect for other people. Now, are the people with the microphones here? I think it's time for some discussion. Does anybody want to ask a question of any panel member? We've heard about the statistics. Consistently, Indigenous people are three times more unemployed. And yes.
I'd just like to ask a question to any panellist, really, just the role of sports and arts as a pathway to employment, moving people, and maybe they're at a pretty low space within themselves, that process, if anyone's got a reflection on that.
The question's about the role of sports and arts in this enterprise. How do we apply sports and arts?
I think we should throw it to the moderator.
To me?
To you.
I watch AFL. very unwillingly. but I've noted that people who play sports, especially the young people, have to learn teamwork and have to be there on time and have to be up for it, they have to be fit. And this, you know, there's no, in competitive sports, there's no room for letting the side down. So, and I'm very impressed with the job that, say, Clontarf Foundation does with getting young men through through school by using sports. It's an incredible process. I've seen it working, and there's no doubt that sports keeps young people healthy and gives them, you know, the aspiration that's suitable for them at the time. You know, you get success by building on success. With the arts, you know, in every Aboriginal community, there's an art form of some kind. In every region of Australia, there's an Aboriginal regional art style, and everybody's involved. And it's, you know, the most visible aspect of Aboriginal culture for Australians and the rest of the world. And I think it's, you know, the one way that everybody has a chance to say that they're Aboriginal is through the arts. Even if, you know, in my case, it's turning up at my daughter's theatre shows. I've been a patron of the arts for a long time. I think it's very important to engage through those, through both sports and arts. I love to see young people coming out of those programs and wanting more. The thing is, how do we get young people to want more? And that's where these great programs that we're hearing about come in.
Could I
comment on that. We actually use sport within our program with some of our participants. We went to one of the footy clubs and we actually have an MOU with them. And so they have a clear understanding, and we do, and so do the boys that are in the program, that unless they go to TAFE, they don't get a game on Saturday. Take a football game away from a boy? Man alive, I've never experienced it. I'm not a boy, I'm not into AFL. But these guys just go depressed. Like, it's just incredible. You've shaken the whole world. Well, do those boys go to TAFE all the next week? Don't miss it. So it goes hand in hand in the sense of all the people working around, and that's where we talk about going to community. You then have the parents supporting this and saying, yes, don't let him have a game unless he goes to TAFE, because if he's not educated, what has he got if AFL doesn't come apart? And we also work in Fitzroy Valley with a sporting chance where we use art and as in dance and sports to get the girls to come to school, which would never have happened before that program was put in place. So it's real.
The question was about affirmative action. If you'd had an affirmative action policy rather than this approach that we've heard about this morning, would you have had the same results? Sorry, James.
No, thank you. I think it's a terrific question, and I think the honest answer is, in my case, the answer would have been no. Being serious about it, what appealed to me about the conversation Andrew and I had was I genuinely believe that when people have jobs, have work, their sense of self-respect increases the way we all know it does, and the vicious cycle, sometimes the descending cycle, can be completely broken. So what was so attractive to me about what Andrew was saying to me is what we need you guys to do is find real jobs for real people and do all you can together, all of us, to try and help those people succeed. But the notion of welfare for welfare's sake or training for training's sake, I think Adrian said and emphasised the point, education, training and work ready. And my sense from the way you were talking at the end of the panel, and I'm being presumptuous here, is you seem to almost emphasise work ready as important, if not more important, than any of those things. And so I think the answer to the question is we wouldn't have been as excited about affirmative action, because I think there have been so many disappointments on both sides of the ledger historically through those programs, whereas specific training for specific jobs I think is a different way of thinking about it.
There's been lots of policies like that, but where I think we needed to engage corporate Australia is at the chief executive and chairman level, and they needed to look you in the eye as a CEO, as a chairman, and know that you were doing it, that you were putting your company on the line, and you were happy about that, you were comfortable about that, and you were saying you weren't doing it because you're a great guy. We're doing it because it's good business. It's only sustainable if it's good business for a CEO or a chairman. And when you could explain that the value of your business is going to improve if you do this, and we need your leadership, and you will be removing the disparity, then it became overwhelming. But look, three or four out of 10 still didn't do it because of the binding nature of that covenant. And you know, but those who did will change the landscape of Australia.
Talking about, you know, having aspirations for communities and that sort of stuff, you know, with 110,000 people already signed up to the movement of Generation One, I think it's a really brilliant platform in order to start having the conversations around mobilising people to want to be better and do better. And whether it's something that, you know, in terms of career and being skills and training, careers and career ready, whether, I guess, corporate Australia will be able to invest in those sort of opportunities within communities, you know, investing in people and saying, you know, here's you know, here's their careers and here's the opportunities. But we want you to want these opportunities just as much as we, you know, we want to give them to you.
Yeah, look, I think, look, a really great point. The I've found that the Crowns, the Lynn Foxes, the Transfield and others, even Fortescues, they have the resources to get out and train directly, but they're not the solution in themselves. They're like little shining lights on the dark horizon. We need government to accept that training for training's sake must become a dinosaur. It makes Indigenous people quite correctly cynical, as my new best friend just said. You know, we are the most educated or trained people, but there's no job. So now we're removing all the wash and the, you know, all the ideology and saying, look, 57,500 jobs, that's enough to break the disparity. Let's train exactly for those jobs. Government, you now have something wonderful, a real responsibility to step up and ensure that training is directed by those employers and is job specific. So when an Indigenous person joins that workforce, they feel valuable because they are value adding on their first day at work. That's the key.
I think that's a pretty important topic, actually. How do we get the government to be more responsive? Now, the gentleman over here.
My name's Harris Van Beek, and I do some work and have done for a long while between schools and businesses around alignment between that, and do some work in some remote communities around that issue. The issue I want to ask James and Andrew was what you've found and what advice you can give to other businesses around the messaging that you needed to give to your own employees around the tolerance for stuff-ups, the tolerance for diverting from productivity that's going to inevitably be required, and at a previous similar gathering, the ANZ rep said at some point they had to accept that some of their branches actually were not ready to have Indigenous people working in their midst. And not least the issues they encountered was racism amongst their own employees. So there's some quite practical issues that go beyond you as leaders saying it must happen to the realities of a person who interfaces with an employee and how the leadership message goes through. And I'm just wondering if you can share some of your insights on that.
Oh, great. Look, I'd love to hear what James says too, but it's so much easier to want something as an employee if the chief executive or chairman wants it. No, it just opens the way, you know. It's you know, and look, I'm not being facetious about this, but if you have a heart to help someone else, and look, let's be frank, I'm afraid you're all fairly accused of that. If you have a heart to help someone else, most people do. You know, 9 out of 10 have that heart. If your CEO or chairman is saying, "I want you to exercise that heart and be a mentor, and I want you to actually really encourage an Indigenous person into your workforce and help them out and hold them close in a professional sense," then it's so much easier for a workforce to volunteer. But it does take, it can't come from HR, it can't come from the diversity officer, it's got to come from the top to say, this is now who we are. And actually, it doesn't hit productivity. In fact, if you're just going to work to make a quid, you know, that becomes pretty unproductive and you feel not great in yourself. But if you feel that your company stands for something more, like doing its little bit to remove the disparity and giving you that wonderful privilege of helping another Australian, well, then that job becomes so much more interesting and productivity goes up. And I tell each chief executive and chairman, don't sign on that form because you're a great guy, you're a big-hearted person. Sign because it's good business.
Now, I just want to regulate this a little bit because we've got a lot of people putting their hands up. Over to you, sir.
Oh, now I've got the microphone. look, I just want to broach the question of, James was talking about 70% of the Aboriginal people living in major cities and places like that. I just want to pose the issue of regional centres and where there's lots of issues with regional centres with drugs and alcohol and crime and violence. But there's people that don't want to move from where they live. That's their land, their country. I want to take you back to Carnarvon in particular. 500 kilometres north, you've got mining. And there's a lot of wealthy people and a lot of richness coming out of that. 1,000 kilometres south, you've got Burswood, which has got the gambling, it's got the casino, and you've got nearby gold and wheat belt and all of those areas. For the people of Carnarvon, if they look east, they see Christmas Island and refugees coming in. If they look west, they've got desert for 2,500 kilometres until, or thereabouts, until they reach Alice Springs. There's something like 9,000 Aboriginal people that live in that Gascoyne region. There's no mining to speak of apart from salt mines just north. How do we actually help those people? Because a great percentage of those young people end up at, down at Greenwich, down at in the prison system. So I was just there must be many other communities in regional places in Australia that are in those holes where there's no mining and there's no gambling. How do we actually handle that? And I just want to close my question by saying I reckon you guys are heroes and the people in this room are heroes and the people that actually are dedicated to this cause are heroes. Because Australia is so much a part of, you know, our Aboriginal culture is so much a part of us. So thank you very much.
Christine, yes.
You're absolutely right. And I've been travelling around Australia recently. I've actually finished working at Burswood. And I've come across in remote places the fact that there isn't employment there. And what do young people do? We get them educated in some bigger centres, we send them back to communities and there are no jobs. And it is a vicious cycle. And it leads to depression, leads to all of those things that you've said. I suppose the bigger picture, we need to look at what businesses can be set up, if any. I mean, housing is an obvious one. But it is a problem that we haven't resolved yet to the most remote communities. And people shouldn't need to leave their communities either. And I'd just love to comment on the gentleman just quickly before. When I did my opening address, I talked about the fabulous support that we had from James, our CEO, and the executives. But the real glinch is the middle line managers, because I think the process is it's always ongoing. They're the ones that do the hiring and firing. And sometimes they forget that our bosses have said, we're doing this program and we'll implement it. And because you've got people coming and going, you've got to constantly remind them that we have signed up for a national program. But ultimately, it's something you've got to chip away at constantly to get results.
Madonna. Sometimes at that level, you also have ignorance. Ignorance on the white people in the sense of, here's an Indigenous person, an Aboriginal person, what do I do with them? You know, it's like, have coffee with them. We ran a cross-cultural course for corporate a few years ago. And these were people that I actually worked with also as a consultant was in that organisation. And I went to the bathroom at morning break and here are all these women all crying. And I just went and said, what is this about? And they went, oh, we didn't know how hard it was for you. We didn't realise. And it's like, whoa, I don't need your sympathy. I mean, I'm working here beside you, you know. And so a lot of that is just being educated. You know, I was not born a citizen of this country. And people look at you and go, oh, you know, that I was not. Because that's what the law was then. And so have we changed and have we come along? I own my own company. I am doing and I'm now working for my people. Because that's where my passion is and that's what I want to do. But we still have to change that divide, the ignorance that is there. And there's also the ignorance on our part in the sense of some of us have not got the history of having people employed. So we don't know what it is like to get out of bed to go to a job. We had some friends come from Fitzroy and they bought their nieces and nephew. The auntie and uncle went out and came back in the evening. And these kids went, where is auntie and uncle going? They're going to work. And so if you don't have a history of it, if you don't have a familiarity, how can you go into it? Anyone?
All right. Look, I'd just pick up on something which Warren Mundine said. It puts a slightly different hue on it, but it's basically you white fellas didn't invent walkabout. That was us black fellas. And forever we've been walking about, you know, making an existence and making good lives for ourselves. That shouldn't stop now. And I respect everyone's right to live where they would like to, but I also respect the fact that going out and coming back, is a wonderful and Aboriginal thing. And that's, you know, travelling to a job or going to a job should be greeted and encouraged. And in fact, it's quite often white people, particularly our unemployment benefit system, which cements people into this spot, like into Alice Springs. There's not a lot of work there either. Thousands of Aboriginal people, and I've spoken to dozens of them, they say, why do you stay here, mate, when there's other opportunities? They say, well, unfortunately, I can't shift my CDP money over there. I can't shift my unemployment benefits over there. If I could, I'd shift over there, and then I could start looking for a job. But right, I don't want to starve when I get there, so I've got to stay here.
Now, sorry, was this Kyra? Oh, yeah, OK. Ray. Over to you, Ray.
Thanks. Congratulations there, Andrew, on getting 50,000 jobs for us mob. My question really is a challenge to James. We've got now skills and trainings for a career. You can get one back on Andrew if we can go from a Generation 1 policy to a Generation 2 and help us get 50,000 businesses, Aboriginal businesses, going. So would you consider that? Because there's a lot of my people who want to be media magnates and mining moguls. So if you can help us with that, we could actually fast-track the next part of our development as Aboriginal people in this country by taking upon ourselves the responsibilities of not only starting businesses, but employing our own people.
James, I need a mentor.
Okay, now, look, just before you start, James, I'm going to regulate this. Kyra, the lady in the green jacket down here, then the lady next to her, and then a man up right up the back, and he's waving at us. Yes, not drowning, waving, yes. Okay, so James, over to you.
I think I'd like to start by saying it seems to me, looking at Australia these days, being a mining magnate's better than being a media magnate. So maybe we should pass over to Twiggy again. But I think, you know, it's a question which has a serious edge to it, delivered in a very charming and humorous way. But I think the answer is that in life, sometimes it's one step at a time. And I think that getting more and more Indigenous people into the workforce will give more and more opportunity for some of those people to obviously look to go out and do their own things over time, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So I think, you know, I think corporates getting there and really taking the commitments that they gave seriously is a huge first step to that, because when the upward cycle of pride and self-respect kicks in, when a lot of these people start having employment and doing well and feeling better about themselves than they did in the past, I'm sure that will give opportunities for people to do their own thing. And Andrew might be bored in a couple of years and want to do it.
I'll come looking for one of their jobs. Just to endorse, I think, your point and James's, let's start where we are. Right, so you know, we do start with numeracy and literacy for 9 out of 10 of our Aboriginal people in the VTEC because they need that. And then it's a driver's license and then it's onwards and upwards. But there is nothing like having a job to get another job or to go and start a business because you've learnt that trade. And that'll be the next step. And I'm really looking forward to the day when we can create tens of thousands of businesses because we have 50,000, 60,000, 70,000, 80,000 Indigenous people, the fastest growing segment of Australia's population, in good work, in good jobs, learning those skills and then getting out and competing against their old boss. Let's see it done.
Oh,
Or you do this, Ray. You sit between two millionaires and you bring a new flyer that says, James was my boss. He's no longer my boss, but I might have something to offer him still. So my colleague Tanya and I, she flew from Darwin, paid her own way. We did a fabulous flyer, and we're all about being Aboriginal employment consultants, so make sure you get that.
Thanks, Marcia. I would just like to talk, my name's Jane Fremantle, talk and perhaps give you a challenge. And I know, Andrew, you love a challenge. You've done an amazing job in getting to 50,000 plus. You've got an enormous groundswell of Australian population behind you. I'd like to challenge you, and I'm stealing your words of Generation 2, to go back to the early years. You're talking, Ganbina's doing amazing work in bringing children from high school into walking that path to be job ready. But we need to go back now really so much further, back to the early years, to create healthy children, healthy environments to enable the kids to learn from the beginning, so we're not having to do this work in high school, because it's been a flow of education from the beginning. My challenge to you for Generation 2.
Okay, what a great point. You know, I often get asked to sponsor health issues and early education issues, etc. And I think there's a wonderful time and place for that. But for me, you begin where you must end, Australia without a disparity. And that's now going to cause enormous pressure on training. And great, bring on the day, bring on the challenge. Training now must change because there's 50 plus thousand jobs. Once that training locks in, then there's a real issue about education. And why is education failing? And why is health failing education, education failing health? And what about the prenatal even, where we've got fetal alcohol syndromes, et cetera, and it's all coming from this demand side pull of employment right down to a child who's now looking at mum and dad and saying, mum, dad, they're going to work. And they're looking at buying a new car, and actually we're going to shift out of this welfare home and we're going to buy a new house, and that's what I want. And I'm actually going to stay at school because I can now see that floodlit path through to a future, and it's not welfare. I'm not going to be encouraged to stay in bed because there is nothing else. And it starts with, you know, that prospect or that guarantee of employment, which then causes pressure on every other bit of the system, right down to that little kid who's thinking, should I get out of bed or not? If they think, well, welfare's my option, they're going to stay in bed. But if there's excitement out there and positivity and potential, and they're singing in their parents, they're out of that bed.
Did the lady next to you want to ask a question? Oh, sorry, Adrian.
Can I just follow on from that? It certainly is our experience with the Ganbina model, and we actually engage kids from prep all the way through. Is our experience is very much is looking at, well, what does a young person want to do? And without exception, when we talk to young people, is they want to get a job. They don't want to become academics. You know, they don't want to be on welfare. You know, and so you've got these two extremes. Well, they don't want to be, you know, highly educated or extremely highly educated and host forums and that. But they don't want to be on welfare either, you know. And so the total engagement that we have around the young people and I suppose the relationship that we have with the young people on our program is a mutual agreement. This is what we will do and this is what you do. We're not government funded, so we don't have to work with the young people. They don't have to actually choose us. So we've got about 290 young people on our program at the moment that are actually saying, we want to work towards a positive future. And we're actually wanting to engage around what we eventually see ourselves doing. Now, if that is actually completing education, if it's going on to, you know, higher training, but we want to get a job. You know, we want to be a part of the economy. And I think this is the change that is now coming through with Aboriginal communities, where, you know, young people, certainly the ones that we're working with, are saying, you know, welfare is not an option. And, you know, I think the biggest challenge that we do have is that,
You know, we have, you know, a Gen 1 with 57,000 jobs. Do we have 57,000 Aboriginal people to go into those jobs? You know, we ran, you know, obviously a smaller sort of strategy in Shepparton, and we called the program Ladders to Success, where we tagged a whole lot of industry people and business people and say, would you commit to jobs if we could get you? And James, yes, it is my passion, work-ready, you know, people. If we could get you a work-ready person, you know, would you take it up? And, you know, we had hundreds of jobs committed in our local community. That frightened us because we didn't have hundreds of Aboriginal people to go into those jobs.
I mean, if I can just interrupt there for 1 second, I mean, I couldn't agree with you more, Adrian, and I think what Andrew's done to get 57,000 commitments is amazing, but I think that the job that community needs to do, government needs to do on the training side, industry needs to do to actually have 50,000 Aboriginals work ready is something that is just a massive, massive job. And, you know, I'm sure we can all achieve it, but it is huge.
Yeah. And work readiness.
It's a high class problem to have, but it's now out there, that landscape's changed, and we've got something we must and can train for.
Yeah, and work readiness isn't a course. Yeah, in terms of our experience, work readiness is developing those life skills, like being able to get up in the morning and head off to the job, being able to manage your cultural, I suppose, responsibilities in terms of family deaths and that sort of stuff, in terms of your requirement to be involved, you know, in a workplace. You know, production lines don't stop simply because you're not there, and part of that is the, you know, is educating, you know, individuals about, well, you know, workplace has a culture as well. The employers that we work with, you know, our discussion isn't about reconciliation or social injustice. Is our discussion is we're going to help you solve a problem, and your problem is you can't recruit skilled young people. Yeah, and you know, and we've got employers now that are actually coming to us and saying, have you got more vacancies? Have you got more people? Have you got more people? This is probably a thing that you're now hearing, Andrew. Have you got people that can actually fill these jobs? And we're saying, no, we're exhausted. You know, we have to wait till the next ones are turning 15 at least so that they can actually be employed. And, you know, so it's great to have, you know, the carrot at the end of the stick. What we need to be doing is now actually showing people that there is that carrot there and what they need to be doing to access those opportunities.
Yeah. Completely agreed. We have about 93 or 4,000 Indigenous job seekers right now, but they don't have the training. Why should they get the training when there's not a job for them? That's been the perennial issue, the best trained people around. Now, I think our challenge, you and I and everyone here, is to have government lift and change its policies to direct those 93,000 into training to a guaranteed job, job-specific, employer-directed training.
And government is a big, not such a stumbling block, but it certainly is one of the things that needs to be tackled. If Ganbina was to operate under government funding, we could not actually achieve what we're actually doing.
Yeah.
Simply based on is the parameter of how government funds and the policies that sit around that. It doesn't, you know, government does not have the flexibility to say, you know, support a young person through education so that they can actually get a full-time job at the end of the day. It actually says, no, wait for the person to be unemployed, then we'll give you money to support that individual.
Can I say that? I need to give credit where credit's due in the sense of the IYMP program that we run, which is Indigenous Youth Mobility Program. The government is actually doing that while it's taken a long time. Within our program, we support and mentor young 16 to 24 year olds in tertiary training or apprenticeships. We also then have a 6 month after that that we support them in the workplace, which I think is a significant change and a fantastic change and a change that is needed. So it's not only that do we train them and support them in that, but transition them into the workforce.
Congratulations on achieving the targets, and hopefully we can get all the people to fill those jobs. Where do you see us? In the main financial centre of Victoria, Melbourne, When you walk those streets, do you see us in a building there? The point I make is this. We have to rethink how we do our economic modelling. We've got to get out of the Centrelink fight on the shade and all the other things that are bad out there, which everybody else can talk about. Traditional owners in this state want to see a major economic stimulus package. And that includes our physical presence in the CBD. You do not see us in the CBD. Why? We're tucked away in the back streets of Northcote and Thornbury and down in King Street with the Heritage Trust, et cetera, et cetera. Our business, our core business, is cultural heritage. And that's part of the tourism stuff, which James and other people are involved in down at South Bank. But where are we down there? Are you prepared to do a strategy around a concept on the Yarra River that creates 1,000 jobs for Aboriginal people, real jobs, that brings in real revenue to Aboriginal people, that is backed by the traditional owners around this state? That's the question for both James and Twiggy.
Okay, look, thank you for that. The answer is, if there's economic empowerment, which is sustainable and not charitable, it will live and grow on its own. So if your idea fits that, I could not support it more. In answer to you, I think your other point is, where are the Aboriginal people in the leadership positions in the CBD and other areas? You know, that is something which we must fix from where we are now. It's no point in imagining something which is not. We have to start with where we are now. So let's get our Aboriginal people into jobs, into high-paying and sustainable jobs, and then have them grow and be mentored up into the successful leadership positions. And it was exactly the concern of Australia Post, if I could use them as an example. They said, Andrew, what is it about Fortescue which is able to get Aboriginal people into supervisory and management positions, i.e. so they're in the city leading? They said, it's quite simple. You don't have a mentor at the entry level and stop there. You have a mentor at the next level, and a mentor at the next level, and a mentor at the next level, so they can get up to being leaders in their businesses, not only in their communities. And it's just that structural rising mentorship which is enabling that, and which I would like to see across now all of corporate Australia. So thanks for your point.
Yes, sir.
Jeff Waters from the ABC. Mr. Forrest, everyone applauds your efforts clearly, but they also applaud the efforts of Rio Tinto in the Pilbara, which is making a promise to have a 14% employment level for Indigenous people, and also, and perhaps more importantly, to dedicate 14% of their outsourcing to Indigenous companies. Do you have similar plans or similar policies, and if not, would you? And secondly, what singular thing could the government do to help kick this program along? And a quick question for Mr. Packer as well. Please correct me if I misheard, but I believe that you'll be personally mentoring somebody yourself. If so, who's the lucky person, and how do you intend doing that?
Sorry.
Look, thank you very much. I applaud companies who want to set targets, 10%, 14%, etc. That's fantastic. What I probably prefer is companies which say, this is who we are as a whole. This is what we all stand for. Every time you join a Fortescue or a Lynn Fox or a Crown, you're joining a company which physically wants to integrate into the Aboriginality, into the people, our first people of Australia. I support targets. That's why we went for 50,000 jobs. But I'd even more encourage the heart of leadership to say, this is who we all are and this is what we all stand for, as opposed to simply a target. Secondly, your question about government. The Australian Employment Covenant kicked off, as you know, Kirribilli House almost 3 years ago. It was set up on a three-part. You know, first, the cart before the horse, secure 50,000 jobs. If you do that, then training will lock in, and then if you do that, then we have that clear and floodlit pathway out of welfare, out of wherever we are, into a job which spans across the Australian economy, those 17 major industry sectors. Now, we're formally putting the challenge out there through this skills and training for a career policy, for government to pick this up as the absolute landscape changer. When you speak to prime ministers or leaders of opposition, you say, we must change policy. They say, well, we need a change to change policy too. Well, with these 50,000 jobs guaranteed now by employers across Australia, we now have a policy they can change to.
Now, thank you.
Madonna and I sound as though we're going to get to know each other better.
Sorry, Kyra. Oh, yeah, Julieta. Julieta? Yes.
Hello, my name is Tessa Pollack. I'm from Katherine in the Northern Territory. And I just wanted to tell you that I work for an 100% owned Indigenous company. And we work for the Jawin people. I know you're familiar with us, Marcia. I know there are other people here from the Territory. And we have a success story. We employ, first of all, we're a tourist company. Our CEO is a Jawin man, and the CEO of the Jawin Association is a Jawin man. So we have approximately 59 permanent employees. 17 of those are Indigenous. One has been employed with the company for 14 years, and the last one has just joined as a 15-year-old the last 2 months because he can't take being in school anymore. Where we find it's very successful is where we have the high school students come and work 2 days a week with us as work experience. From there, they want to come and work with us because, yes, we have two mentors on staff. All non-Indigenous staff go through cultural awareness workshops. We've just had a young man who came to us, a local Catherine man, who came to us nearly 4 years ago as a 16-year-old. He's just completed his commercial cookery course, Charles Darwin University. He's in finals for the Austin Ash Apprentice of the Year Award. He's now running one of our operations, which is a cafe in Catherine. You might say, well, no, there's no problem. We have no problem with training, no problem with employing, and no problem with retention. Our problem is infrastructure. If I just might tell you about two brothers who are working for us and worked for us for the last 2 years. In April this year, their father, 44-year-old father, passed away of a heart attack 3 days after the 18-year-old's birthday, who we all attended, including Clontarf and everything they're doing so well. Because he was dependent on the family, and now he's now passed away, the family are going to have to leave their housing territory home because they're earning too much money to stay there. They suggested to me, should we stop working so that mother and the rest of the family can stay there? No, we said, we encourage them to do so and look to go into private accommodation. There is none. There's no housing, territory housing, there's no private accommodation. It doesn't matter what you want to pay, there's no housing in Catherine for people to live in. So once you've got all the success stories, and we really are a success story, you've also got to look in regional Australia at the infrastructure that goes with it, transportation, housing and everything, because trying to get people out of our remote communities, which we want to do, they won't leave and come singly, they want to bring their family, and there's no housing. So my question to you is, going past generation 2 to 3, what do we do in the future there? Thank you.
That's a really important point. And when Mark Abib was travelling around Australia doing consultations, and I was thinking if they could put some of the millions of dollars that they do put aside for Aboriginal anything, then they need to look at housing. Charles always talks about here in Melbourne. It's really difficult because a lot of Aboriginal people are not based right here in the CBD, so they've got to travel long distances to get to work. In Perth, when I was placing people, sometimes they didn't have stable accommodation in Perth, and that would make such a huge difference to them being able to turn up to work every day, go home to a stable environment, We're fortunate that we do access the services of Nyaarla projects, but again, that's just 16 to 24 year olds. So we have a formal partnership with them, and that was great. But ultimately, when you think of what could we do for Aboriginal people with employment, a bit like Aboriginal hostels, but you need to have one just for workers, not just in the capital cities, but also in the regional remote areas, because that would make such a huge difference.
Can I just pick up on that very quickly? There is observed policies such as the ones you've just touched on. If you actually become successful and get a job, then you lose the house you're living in, and if you've got a whole bunch of codependents, then they're probably more likely to spare you for getting a job than not. So it's a reverse incentive. We have to remove that. And I'd go further to say that as the Commonwealth or the states are already funding the houses, the point of the Commonwealth and the states owning those houses and having the Aboriginal people living in them, knowing that they could lose them at any point in time, unsurprisingly leads to very little care or pride in the house. And therefore the maintenance bills by the owners, the Commonwealth, goes through the roof. It would be so much cheaper if we got away from that false economy and gave Aboriginal people the right to own or to earn their right to own that house, so that they would feel a sense of pride and they knew if they looked after it, if they paid off some or part of it, it would be theirs forever.
Now, I'll allow you to ask a question. Keep it short. No more war stories, please. We all know about the housing problem. And then I want to squeeze this man in up here. He's got his hand up. Okay. Brother. No, hang on, mate. We've got a lady here, then you. You've got to have the microphone so we can all hear you.
Sorry about that. I'm listening. I'm hearing a lot of great things happening for Indigenous people, and certainly empowering choice, which I thought was great for that young guy who was in the banking. But how are we bringing this out to remote Australia? Universities are doing good jobs at this by sending out their educators and nurses and the like, but are we reaching out to the remote areas to empower people out there, bringing them back into... You can't remove people from their cultural and social context, but how are we reaching... Like, I'm about to go into remote Australia as well to educate children with the university, a team of students and the like. But can we bring people here, perhaps, and have networks and teams of people engaging with these people in the workforce and then sending them back to empower their own communities? That's something I'd like to see happening. I hear a lot in metropolitan.
Okay, look, very quickly, you don't have to lock Aboriginal people up in their communities and keep them there forever. Mm. Aboriginal culture doesn't make you incompetent. It doesn't stop you from being cosmopolitan. There are Aboriginal people in this room who've been all over the world and worked in other parts of the world as well. Including myself, and many of us speak other languages, not just Aboriginal languages, but languages from other parts of the planet. This, you know, city thing about, you know, we have to stay traditional and we're so wedded to our culture, you know, we're going to pass out and faint if we leave our country. It's a fantasy. We need to get over it. We need to get young people, you know, fulfil their dreams. And if they want to go to school and the only school is a boarding school, get over it. Send them to boarding school if they're happy to do that and their parents agree. We've got kids here in colleges at the University of Melbourne. They're doing great. They love it. I've got Jeff up the back there from Trinity College. 19 this year, is it, in Trinity? 19 from all over Australia this year. And no problem. They love it. They love it.
And I'd agree with Marcia.
Can I just give this lady a quick clap, though?
I'd agree with Marcia, I mean, because it's not isolated to remote communities. In fact, if you do the figures, it's roughly 20% of the population is remote, 20% is in metro, and 80% are in rural communities. So the rural communities like Shepparton, where we operate from, they're facing exactly those same those same issues. You know, if they want to access higher education and that sort of stuff, is, you know, they've got to be prepared to actually chase their dream, and in many cases that's actually coming to Melbourne and actually getting the training opportunities here. And that, so rural communities right across Australia are facing exactly that same thing. Doesn't mean that you get any less connected, you know, with your community. You know, in fact, I just went home, on the weekend. Just to, you still do need to touch base.
Our program runs like that. Our program is for remote areas because you can't get the training there. They don't have universities at Yuendamu. They don't have TAFEs at Yuendamu. But this program brings, and as Christine says, we have housing involved with it. So we mentor 24/7. This is skilling up so that then they can go back to their community. We had one girl from Broome came to Perth and had no hope of getting a job, and her attitude and the whole rest. You know, it was just incredible. But this girl then came to Perth and went to university and then felt so important and so alive. She then went back to her community and then headed up a kindergarten. So fantastic. And she's gone back to her community. She couldn't get that there. There was no way that she could have, because of family issues, you know, because of the whole structure of where she was there. And now that girl, she's not on welfare.
Communities can hold people back too.
Yes.
Communities can hold people back. You've got to let people fly. And, you know, go out in the world and experience for themselves and take it back to the community. Brother.
Thank you, Professor Langdon. I'd like to pay acknowledgements to the local Wurundjeri. I walk on their country, like a lot of people here, and all the visitors, welcome to Melbourne. I've been in business here for 15 years. I know what it's like to pick yourself up from the gutter. I used to be an alcoholic and recovering. I'm still a recovering drug addict and alcoholic. I've run a business for 15 years. But what I'd like to ask Mr. Forrest is that how do you silence the cynics by saying you're doing great things for Aboriginal people? And I'm a stern believer of education, training and real jobs. But are you avoiding matching Rio Tinto and BHP's royalty payments to traditional owners? Is this an evasive tactic? Because I think that would be the biggest cynical part of this if that's a real case. Mr. Packer, I know a lot of people that are working down at your casino and they come from diverse backgrounds, and I commend you on that, and I think that's just a great effort. But I'm finding a bit of a smokescreen with Mr. Forrest because he's still in the courts with the Yindabandi people and he wants to pay them less than 4 cents in every $1,000 for the minerals that he takes off his land, off their land. That's all I have to say.
Look, thank you. Whether or not it's government welfare, corporate welfare or mining welfare, Fortescue doesn't encourage it. Now, it is the easiest thing, particularly for a chief executive with a time frame of being 5, maybe 7 years in a job, just to write out a cheque and solve their native title issues. That's encouraged under the law. But Fortescue does not support it. Fortescue wants to see long-term sustainability. We encourage housing, we encourage training, and we encourage employment. And whether or not we end up paying a lot more out of that really is not the great consequence. In Port Hedland, we have a commitment there for about 8 or 9 houses. We support around 150 houses. So it's who we are, we live and breathe it, and solving an Aboriginal dispute with a chequebook we find is a very short-term and alienating solution.
Okay, has somebody got a mic there? Yeah, I'm not going to stop the debate, it's just that nobody can hear you if you don't have a mic.
Either, but I think if we're looking at long-term sustainability and with the influence, and make no mistake, you can make a difference, sir. And you are making a difference as far as opening the eyes and getting big industry in behind you. And I have to commend you for that, because you're doing what government have failed to do for the last 40 years. And taking on that, I commend you for that, Andrew. But I think for the long term, Aboriginal people need to own some of the service industries so that the money doesn't run out. And I agree, let's not write out cheques, because in the past it's just been squandered. Then what more could we expect, because it's traditional people trying to break their way into the 21st century. We need to ease that. That's why education and training is really, really important. And I really do think that you can make the difference. But I think if you put the same amount of energy into acquiring some of the service industry so that when these people were trained up, they actually owned some of these companies or shares in your great company, I think you'd be doing everyone a bigger favour, because that alleviates the burden left on the taxpayer. Thanks.
Okay, so I'm trying to squeeze in three more people and we've got 2 minutes. Can we do it quickly? So I'll tell you who they are. Your business partner there, then the lady up the back, and then this young man, and then we're out of time.
Just quickly, it's more a comment because there's been a lot of talk about work readiness and pre-employment. And for Madonna and Adrian, they've obviously eloquently talked about the need and the crucial element of work readiness. And I would like to see Generation One to be really prescriptive to government in terms of directive, saying this is how it's got to look, this is what it should be, this is what it should be, how it should be delivered. Otherwise, we will do what we've always done, and government will do what's required, the work readiness program, the work readiness policy, without really understanding what is required from an Aboriginal perspective. So you need Aboriginal people to run that agenda. It needs to be prescriptive to government. It has to be specific to the agencies that are going to be operating it and delivering it, because otherwise we won't get the life skills, the empowerment and the self-worth and self-confidence that's needed in these non-accredited programs. At the moment, government privileges accredited training, Cert 1 employability, Cert 1 preparation for work. I work in an area where it's all about life foundational skills and that confidence, self-worth, self-esteem, and taking that social reality and understanding where people are coming from, a social disadvantage, despair and dysfunction. If you want them to move from that to work, you need to understand where they're coming from and you need to work with them from where they're at. So, if anything, absolutely the direction needs to be work readiness and pre-employment, but it must be very prescriptive and very directive. Aboriginal people.
Can I completely endorse that? Generation One is really about, we hope, helping government keep to its part of the employment covenant, which is to create that specific training, that job-specific employer-directed training. So when an Indigenous person joins the workforce, they feel valuable because they are valuable.
I'd really like to hear Julia Gillard make a commitment to this, just as Kevin Rudd did. You know, and let's remove the obstacles from the government programs. They're putting obstacles in the way. Couldn't agree with you more. Okay, and this young man, okay, let's do this young man, then the lady up the back. We're running out of time. Sorry, we're even over time. I apologise to everybody.
G'day, I'm Isaac Young. In response to what everyone's been saying, I'd like to thank Andrew for the opportunity. I'm Carmel Young's little brother. They've provided me with the opportunity to get a traineeship with ANZ through the help of people like Stephanie Craze, and I've found a lot of support through also an organisation called Aboriginal Employment Strategy. They've just really helped me. I was thinking of quitting Year 11 and, you know, just not going to school anymore and getting a job so I could help out the family. But I decided to stay on in year 12 and then I found out about this scholarship, a traineeship, and now that through such a program that Andrew has provided, I've been able to, see that there's more than just getting a job, you know, getting, just trying to play sports and getting on the welfare, stuff like that. I've found that, you know, I can achieve what I want to achieve through going to a traineeship. Now I want to go to uni. I want to, work my way up the corporate ladder. Maybe be just as rich as Andrew. see what happens. But I'd just like to thank you again. Just show everyone here that there is such success stories as myself. And I'm a Collingwood supporter, so there. Thank you.
Yes. Thanks for that.
Yeah, you've got more fire in your belly than I had at your age. I reckon you'll get there.
Hello, I come from arts and education. I don't really belong in industry. And I would like to see a far greater emphasis on the contribution that Aboriginals have made to art. I can still remember when I was in my early 20s seeing a great performance of Aboriginal theatre, a great film by Aboriginal. I'm now 66 and I haven't forgotten them. How many people acknowledge that it was Aboriginal art that brought Australia into the 21st century, not the other way around? Aboriginal art is an extraordinary success story. There are paintings in our state art house and so on. And yet I think they receive too little acknowledgement. A couple of weekends ago, I happened to go to Queensland just to get away from the winter. And to my horror, I discovered that there was a major gathering of Aboriginal dancers in the north that I would have given my left arm to go to. Where was it? Was it on the ABC? Was it in the newspapers? No. Aboriginals have a huge contribution to make to the arts, and I'd like to see much more emphasis on that than on companies like Rio Tinto Zinc or BP. And I'll say no more.
Well, I'll just say in defence of, you know, the mining companies, you know, I don't know what the figures are for most of the companies, but I know for Rio Tinto, 8% of their national workforce is Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander. So, you know, congratulations to them. I'd like to see other companies reaching a target like that. And just remind you that in many parts of Australia, Aboriginal people are not just 2.5% of the population, but in many parts of the country, 15, 16, 20, 25, and even 90% of the people, and they need jobs. So, you know, if the mining company will give people jobs and they want the jobs, I call that a good deal. So I really want to thank... I want to thank our panel speakers for a wonderful discussion. I want to thank you all for being here and for joining in the conversation. My apologies for not being able to fit in all of the questions from you. Thank you very much to GenOne, to the online audience, and a big thank you to the University of Melbourne, who are so supportive of those of us here who want to get involved in things like this. So let's show our appreciation to Andrew, Madonna, James, Adrian, and Christine. And a big thank you to GenerationOne and all of their team, all of their volunteers and members doing a wonderful job. Thanks to you all.
Professor Langton, just something on behalf of all your fans here, online and in person. Can I thank you? You've done a spectacular job. You've made some really, really wonderful points, perhaps the most powerful and relevant. And on behalf of our audience, may I present you with our little gift of thanks.
Thank you very much.
Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you. That's it from us. Thank you very much. Thanks to the traditional owners again. Please keep the conversation going. Go to the website, the GenerationOne website, join the conversation, download the policy paper and send in your comments. This policy is terrific. I've read it. I totally agree with it. This is what we need to do. So it's over to you now, and thank you so much for your time.